sadly, we're not able to offer refreshments to help you to recuperate after the service. Instead, we just hope that you'll be able to meet together. And Jill is thinking about running a semaphore class for you to be able to communicate with each other without actually getting too close. So if anybody wants to learn semaphore, please have a word with Julie after the service. And no doubt Julie will have a word with me too. So please stand. Grace, mercy, and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ be with you.
And also with you.
And then let us say it together, this prayer. It's a prayer that goes, loving God, fill us with your life-giving, joy-giving. No, don't say it. It'll come later. It's difficult. It's the phrasing is problematic. So I thought if you heard it first, then we'd be able to say it together afterwards. So, loving Lord, fill us with your life-giving, joy-giving, peace-giving presence, that we may praise you now with our lips and all day long with our lives, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Is that okay? Let's say it together. Loving Lord, fill us with your life-giving, joy-giving, peace-giving presence, that we may praise you now with our lips and all day long with our lives, through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. And then please be seated. I think the hymn now will be one that you don't know, and I hope it's one that you'll enjoy listening to. The words which keep repeating are Kyrie eleison, and we can sing those together if you want to do that. Kyrie eleison, Christe eleison, Kyrie eleison. And that comes as the refrain at the end of each verse. So let's listen now to Empty, Broken, Here I Stand. serve you with reverence and know your peace at our lives' end, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Now we're going to hear "The Spirit Lives to Set Us Free, Walk, Walk in the Light," and I ask you all to stand.
From Philippians chapter 2, verses 1 to 13. and his love comforts you. You have fellowship with the Spirit, and you have kindness and compassion for one another. I urge you then to make me completely happy by having the same thoughts, sharing the same love, and being one in soul and mind. Don't do anything from selfish ambition or from a cheap desire to boast, but be humble toward one another, always considering others better than yourselves. And look out for one another's interests, not just for your own. The attitude you should have is the one that Christ Jesus had. He always had the nature of God, but he did not think that by force he should try to remain equal with God. Instead of this, of his own free will, he gave up all he had and took the nature of a servant. He became like a human being and appeared in human likeness. He was humble and walked the path of obedience all the way to death, his death on the cross. For this reason, God raised him to the highest place above and gave him the name that is greater than any other name. And so, in honor of the name of Jesus, all beings in heaven, on earth, and in the world below will fall on their knees, and all will openly proclaim that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father.
Jesus came back to the temple, and as he taught, the chief priests and the elders came to him and asked, "What right do you have to do these things? Who gave you such a right?" Jesus answered them, "I will ask you just one question, and if you give me an answer, I will tell you by what right have to do these things. Where did John's right to baptize come from? Was it from God or from human beings?" They started to argue amongst themselves, "What should we say? If we answer from God, he'll say to us, 'Why then did you not believe John?' But if we say from human beings, we're afraid of what the people might do, because they're all convinced that John was a prophet." So they answered Jesus, "We don't know." And he said to them, "Neither will I tell you then by what right I do these things. Now what do you think? There was once a man who had two sons. He went to the older one and said, 'Son, go and work in the vineyard today.' 'Don't want to,' he answered. But later he changed his mind and went. Then the father went to the son, to the other son, and said the same thing. 'Yes, sir,' he answered. But he didn't go. Which one of the two did what his father wanted?" "The older one," they answered. This is the word of the Lord.
I think there's a problem with the switch, Jilly, but anyway, a bad workman always blames his tools. We're going to do something different today, and I need your help and your cooperation, because the sermon actually is going to be preached by you and not by me. I shall be talking, but then nobody, I hope, will be listening to me. You'll be getting on with your own particular things. But we're going to do some sculpting. And you'll notice in the pews in front of you that there's a hammer and there's some chisels there for you to use. Have you all got them? Anybody who hasn't put their hands up? Well, we'll see that Paul will bring them round to you during the course of what's going on. But first of all, we need to have in our midst the rock that we're going to chisel out our sculpting from today, and I've asked Tom if he would be so kind as to bring it in for us. And to bring it not to the middle of the church, but to bring it up right to where I'm standing at the moment. And while we're working on this, if we work together in family groups so that each family produces its own sculpture, and if you're on your own, then just do your own sculpting. Can you put it here, please? Slippery, and Mum calls out, "Be careful, dear, don't Mind you don't fall into the ditch. Oh, suddenly. Oh, and all the wetness and the smell and the coldness and the shock and the isolation sort of all sort of sweep round the little child. And what position does the little child adopt? First of all, where do the hands go? Are they clenched or are they open? Where do the arms go? Are they up in the air or are they down at the side? Where do the feet go? Where's the head go? Is it looking out for mummy or is it looking down and saying, oh, what a terrible situation I'm in? And the mouth, what about the mouth? Does it remain closed or does it open out? So you make that sculpture. And if you're on your own, make it for yourself physically. If you're on in the family, then organize the person who's been the living sculpture into the kind. And then in a moment or so, I shall say to you, everybody, demonstrate what you think the sculpture will look like. Is that okay? Is that okay? Second thing that we're going to look at is the incredible Hulk. Now I know nothing about, well, not nothing, I looked up, I googled it, to be honest, about the incredible Hulk. But can you very quickly sort of get your sculpture to look like an incredible Hulk? I know some members of the congregation are too small to do incredible Hulks, but I'm sure you can have a try. Right, all together, on your feet. Incredible Hulk. Where are your feet? Where are your hands? Are you up here or down there?
Down there.
What about your jaw? How is your jaw feet? What about your eyes? What are your eyes doing? Are they glaring or are they soft and welcoming? And how does it feel? How does it feel to be an incredible Hulk? How does the world feel? And are you angry? Or are you sad? Are you happy? Are you joyful and triumphant? How do you feel? Okay, now sit down. This lesson that Emma read to us this morning was the story about Jesus in the temple. And Jesus is there in the temple, talking to the people. And he's surrounded by a great crowd of people. What's he talking about? He's talking about the kingdom of God. He's talking about God coming to take control of our lives, take control of our world, to bring peace and prosperity and joy and hope and thanksgiving and praise and glory. It's a wonderful, thrilling talk that he's giving to the people. And then suddenly, along come the high priest and his entourage. And they stand at the edge of this crowd and they realize that here's a problem. Because they've come here to disrupt and they've come here to drive out. You! What do you think you're doing? You're coming to Jerusalem on Sunday riding on the back of a donkey. And all the crowds are proclaiming you as a king, as the Messiah. How dare you do this? What right have you to do this? What right have you to imagine that you are God's Messiah and that you are the Savior of the people of Israel? And then after that, you come into this temple. You come into this church. You tear down all the pictures off the walls. You turn over the pews. You throw the altar to one side. And what right have you to do this? What desecration? What impertinence? What pride? What hubris? What right have you to do this? How can you explain yourself? By what authority in heaven or on earth have you to do this kind of thing? This is what I want you to imagine. And this is what I want you to portray in the sculpture that you're going to do now. Is that all right? Okay. I know it's tough. But where do your feet go? I mean, when the high priest stands there at the edge of the crowd talking to Jesus, where do his feet go? Is he got a foot forward? Is he standing there, or is he on the retreat? And then, so the arms, where do the arms go? And are both arms the same, or is one of them doing something and the other arm doing something else? And then the head, where's the head? Is it thrust forward, or is it set back? Where is he looking? And is he glaring, or is he looking softly, welcomingly, warmly at the object of his focus? Have a think about that for a few minutes. Try and imagine yourself in the scene. Try and see this high priest sort of, I think, seething with rage, but completely impotent because he daren't do a thing because of the great crowd that's around Jesus. And yet Jesus is undermining everything that he stands for. And he's threatening the security and the peace of the Jewish nation by what he's doing. Jesus is a threat. How do you express this in your sculpture? Now, the last one I think will be the most difficult for all of us. express Jesus. For example, when Jesus hears the, Jesus is talking to the crowd, he's full of enthusiasm about the kingdom of God. I mean, he's not ashamed of the kingdom of God. He's proud of the kingdom of God. And he's proud to be able to announce that God's kingdom is coming, and it's coming through him. He's willing to offer everything that he has to see that the kingdom of God comes. And he's talking to people, and the people are listening. The people are taking it in. And he's full of thanksgiving and gratitude. He's full of expectation and hope. And then suddenly these folks come. How do you think he feels? And how do you think he expresses what he feels in his bodily attitude? Does he stand with his foot forward ready to confront? Or is his feet, are his feet somewhere else? And is his body leaning forwards? Or is it backwards in defense? Or is it equally balanced on both feet? And with his arms, what is he doing? What does Jesus do with his arms when he's thinking about the high priest and what the high priest and his compatriots are doing? And Jesus' hair, how is that arranged in relation? What's the attitude of the hair in relation to the Sadducees, the high priests who are talking to him? And the eyes, how are his eyes? Are they glaring defiantly? And the mouth, the jaw, how is the jaw set? Have a think about that for a few minutes. And I know it's going to be difficult. And I know that 5 minutes after you've done it, you say, well, I wouldn't have done it that way, I would have done it this way. But how do you want to sculpt the figure of Jesus as he stands there in the temple that day with a crowd of people round about him and the authorities coming and they're threatening his life? Standing there in his peasant's robes, peasant's clothes, poor man, come out of the villages, and is confronted by the top brass of the Jewish nation. The king and the queen, the prime minister, and all the officers of government are there. How does Jesus respond to them? How do you make Jesus in your rock appear? You ready? Let me see how does it look? Yeah, the hands are there. Yep, the hands are there, all the hands are there. And stands there in front of the high priest and all his enemies, is that more than anything else in all the world, he wants these people to become his friends. He wants these people to share his love. And he wants these people who are wanting his death and destruction to show him their love and their affection. And that's something. it's something which is built into the sculpture by the holding out of the hands. Come unto me. You may be quivering with rage. You may be desperate to destroy. But I want to love you. And I want to embrace you. I want to hold you. And tell you it's all right. All will be well. You sit down. Thank you all very much indeed for sharing in that. I'm very, very grateful indeed. I think you're wonderful. You think you're wonderful too?
Yes.
That's fine. We're going, I think the next slide is the slide of the creed. When we've been putting into our sculpture our own particular creed about what we believe about Jesus and about the world in which Jesus lives. Now we're going to put it into words, and the words, in fact, will echo what we did in the sculpture. So please stand. Trust in God the Father who made all things. Do you believe and trust in his Son Jesus Christ who redeemed the world? And do you believe and trust in the Holy Spirit who gives life to the people of God? And this is the faith of the Church. Sessions to God, bringing before him the particular needs and concerns which we as a congregation have, and Andy and Katie and family are going to lead us in our prayers. So please kneel or sit.
Let's pray. Lord God, so often we want to pray for others, but we don't know how. We can't remember names or numbers or other issues weighing heavily on our hearts. Thank goodness that you know what we need when we pray.
So we begin in the moment. We bring in the moment those names and faces, images and desires for others that pop in and out of our minds throughout the day. The old lady at the bus stop.
The young mum at the checkout.
The chap up the road who's calling for his dog.
The teachers struggling with their classes.
A young family who can't make ends meet.
Those without work who can't find new jobs.
Those with mental health issues and seeking help.
Those who know they need help for whatever reason but are too ashamed to ask or are ignored.
Lord, for all those people and countless others, we offer our prayers. We know you do not need reminding. But you do need willing workers, even us, to help them know your love and have their needs met. Hear our ramblings, Lord God. Amen.
We simply pray, Lord, that you help us show your love to those around us. Amen.
Let us say together, Our Father in heaven,
say that a couple of things. Val Bornaise has heard from the food bank to say that although they've got a lot of supplies because they had some deliveries from supermarkets, they are running short of a few things. Biscuits with long dates on them, tinned potatoes or instant mash, a few other things that there are lists around, and Val will let us know. If you would like to bring anything, the box is in the porch. If you put the things into the carrier bags there, then they won't be touched for a few days, and then Val will take them to the food bank. But thank you very much for your contributions. Ros has also said we can leave them in the porch at Church Lodge in the box there. So if you want to take things there, if that's easier, do that too. Thank you. The second thing is that we had a letter this week from Bishop Paul, who has asked us, in the light of the recent developments with coronavirus, would we please make sure that we keep our distance, especially after services, that we make sure we're not socializing in groups too small or getting too close together. So what we've decided to do today, I'll open those doors in a minute. We will usher you out slowly, because obviously you'll be hand sanitizing as you go out. But please don't gather just outside the door, making it difficult for other people to leave. If you can move further away or round the front, if you want to chat to each other in groups of six or less, please feel free to do that. At the same time, Paul will open the back doors and he'll be showing people from the back to be able to go out of those doors. So if you just be patient, just wait till you're shown out, and then we'll make sure everybody is safe. Thank you very much.